In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Welcome to the Lenten Retreat by Dominicans in India, the fourth day in his footsteps. My dear brothers and sisters, as we begin this retreat, let us begin by paying homage to the people who are at war with COVID-19. We shall pray for all those who have gone away from this world because of COVID-19. We shall also pray for all those who are working behind to alleviate the pain and suffering of the people because of this COVID-19. We know that this situation is not desired by humanity. We all want to live a life of happiness, but it has come on us all of a sudden. And what is our response? We know that many of our countries have resigned themselves to complete lockdown. All the worship places, all the malls, all the socializing places are completely cut off from the access of ordinary people. When I celebrate Holy Eucharist in our community, I remember all those people who are deprived of the celebration and participation in the Most Holy Eucharist physically. In this situation, people might think that their spirituality is gone because the celebration of the Holy Eucharist is the social expression of one's faith for a Catholic or for a Christian. And once we think that our socializing means are cut off, sometimes we may feel that we are completely lost. In this situation, let us not be discouraged. Let us listen to the Word of God, who tells us, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my victorious right hand." Isaiah chapter 41:10. Again, we read in Psalm number 23:4, "Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." My dear friends, this situation could be read as a situation to test our spirituality. But again, it is a time to tell the world that we have an authentic spirituality. It is the time to go into our own homes and our own rooms and to rediscover the beauty of our spirituality. Recently, I got a message from a sister saying, "Father, we are all locked down, but we are having day-long adoration in front of the Blessed Sacrament." I have told many families to make use of this time for spiritual renewal, to pray an extra rosary, to read the Word of God a little more, to do the way of the cross, and also do many other spiritual activities within the house itself. This is not the time just we are resigned to the power of evil. This is the time to fight against the evil one in whatever ways. My dear friends, for today's retreat, we have taken the theme spiritual communion. To speak about a spiritual communion, we need to speak about the Most Holy Eucharist. Compendium of the Catechism of the Catholic Church says, "The Holy Eucharist is the very sacrifice of the body and blood of Jesus, which he instituted to perpetuate the sacrifice of the cross throughout the ages until he returns." Catechism of the Catholic Church says it is the memorial of the Lord's passion and resurrection. In simple words, the Most Holy Eucharist is the reenactment of the sacrifice of the Lord that happened in 2000 years ago. We read in 1 John chapter 3:8, "The reason for the Son of Man to appear on this world is to destroy the works of the devil." And on the cross, Jesus conquered sin, death, and thereby the devil. The Holy Eucharist is the celebration of the victory of Christ, victory on the cross. It is a celebration of the intense love of the Father shown through Jesus Christ, shown through the sacrifice of Christ. The intense love the Father has for each one of us is shown on the cross. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, so that those who believe in Him may not be perished, but will have life eternal. John 3:16. The intense love of God is shown on Calvary, and that is the Holy Eucharist. That is the first Holy Eucharist. And we celebrate the Holy Eucharist every day on the altar. The Holy Eucharist can have all blessings and all graces. We shall list a few of them. We will not dwell on them in detail. That could be another talk. I shall just list them one by one. We are filled with every heavenly grace. We read in Ephesians chapter 1, 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. My dear friends, if any person receives any blessing from God, that is through Christ. By His very coming on this earth in human flesh, and by His very death on the cross and the resurrection, through this event, every grace comes into a person's life. Every spiritual blessing, every grace that we receive comes through Jesus Christ and through the Holy Eucharist. Second one is Holy Eucharist facilitates our union with Christ, Catechism of the Catholic Church 1391. And it preserves, increases, and renews the life of grace received in baptism, Catechism of the Catholic Church 1392. We receive the pledge of eternal glory. It becomes the medicine of immortality. It is an antidote to death. We read in Hebrews chapter 9, 13 to 14. For if the sprinkling of defiled persons with the blood of goats and bulls and with the ashes of heifer sanctifies for the purification of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without blemish to God, purify your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? The Lord dies on the cross to destroy the works of the devil and to give us life eternal. Holy Eucharist gives us food that makes us to live for Christ forever. It brings about communion with the Holy Trinity. It also brings about communion with the rest of the members of the mystical body of Christ. It also brings about fellowship with the entire humanity and the creation as a whole. It strengthens charity and wipes away even the venial sins. Eucharist preserves us from future mortal sins. Holy Communion separates us from sin, cleansing us from past sins and preserving us from future sins. My dear friends, to explain each of these fruits and the innumerable other graces that we receive through the Holy Eucharist, we may dwell on another time. But at this moment, after listing these fruits, let me get into the present situation. Now all of our faithful are not able to participate in the celebration of the Holy Eucharist. And in this context, how can we make ourselves avail to the greatest gifts and graces of the Holy Eucharist? And the answer is spiritual communion. What is this spiritual communion? What is the spirituality? What is the biblical foundation of a spiritual communion? That is the point of our reflection. According to St. Thomas Aquinas, it is a communion of desire, like we have baptism of desire in danger of death. With regard to baptism of desire, it is said when a person is not baptized but is in the danger of death, if that person desires what church intends for a person who is willing to receive the baptism, then that person is baptized through the baptism of desire. The communion of desire is of a similar kind. We do not physically and actually receive the Lord in the most holy Eucharist, but the effects of the Holy Eucharist is applied to the person who spiritually communicating with the most holy Eucharist. Spiritual communion is a wonderful divine plan for our participation in the body and blood of Christ. In this situation, when everything is locked down, this wonderful plan is very much applicable to each one of us who is sitting at home and have no access to the Holy Eucharist. Nevertheless, we need to remember, my dear friends, in every church where a priest is present, in every monastery where monks are present, religious are present, the Holy Eucharist is being celebrated. That is the consolation that we all have. But for the faithful, the spiritual communion could be the after thing that we can do it. St. Thomas Aquinas defines spiritual communion as an ardent desire to receive Jesus in the most holy Eucharist, in communion at Mass, and lovingly embracing Him as if we had actually received Him. There are three things that need to be reflected upon. The first one is the ardent desire. When we go back to the Old Testament, we can see the desire and longing for physical comforts by the people. We have in the book of Genesis, Hagar, who sought for her thirsty son, water, and God provided water for her. Genesis chapter 21:19. And towards the end of the book of Genesis, we have Jacob and his sons who go to Egypt, where another son of Jacob, Joseph, is the second in command, and God provided food to these people. In the book of Exodus chapter 16 and 17, we see Israelites hungered for physical food and drink in the desert, and God provided them with water from the rock and manna from heaven. The widow and the son during the time of Prophet Elijah were dying of hunger, and God provided the provision for their sustenance. 1 Kings chapter 17, 13. These are all physical hunger or thirst for physical food and drink. God, who was able to provide Israelites and the people of the covenant with physical food and physical drink, will be able to satisfy our every desire for spiritual food and spiritual drink. Even when God was providing them with the physical food and drink, God was constantly asking them to desire for Himself, for desire for God. We read in the prophet Amos chapter 8:11, "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine for bread or thirst for water, but rather for hearing the words of the law." This could be a situation of such a famine. The famine may not be for the word of God, but for the spiritual blessings or graces that we need to have in our life. A famine for the Holy Eucharist. And because of this invitation of the Lord to long for Him, for God, for spiritual blessings, we have psalmist, and psalms are the expressions of the people's longing for God. In Psalm number 42:2, we read, "My soul thirsts for God, the living God." And again, in Psalm number 63:1, we read, "O God, You are my God, I shall seek You earnestly. My soul thirsts for You, my flesh yearns for You in a dry and weary land where there is no water." This is the expression of people's longing for God. And God has answered their longing in many ways, through kings, through prophets, and at last, through His Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus comes and answers, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life." Our physical hunger and thirst for food and drink are momentary. That can be simply satisfied by the Lord. But our spiritual hunger for spiritual food and drink can be satisfied by only our faith in the Lord. Faith in the Lord who provides us with the spiritual food and spiritual drink, the most precious body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. In John 6:35 we read, "Jesus said to them, 'I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst.'" In John 7:37, Revelation chapter 21, 6 and 22:17, he tells about quenching of our thirst without any cost. My dear friends, such longing for God was a prerequisite for any reception of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Such a longing has resulted in the lives of many saints, a source of charity, holiness, and faith. For example, we have the experience of Saint Teresa of Child Jesus, as it is written in her autobiography about her experience of spiritual communion. We need to remember that earlier times, people did not have every day or weekly Holy Eucharistic celebration. Even saints like Saint Teresa of Child Jesus needed to get permission from the spiritual director to go for the Holy Eucharist and receive the body and blood of Christ. In such situations, the saints used to desire for the Lord intensely in their heart. This spiritual communion was a spiritual exercise they used to do many a times, even a day. So it is not a new thing. It is an age-old Catholic practice. Only after the Vatican Council II, that practice was not very much practiced. But in the writings of St. John Paul II, then Benedict XVI, we have references to this spiritual communion. So desire is a prerequisite to receive the Holy Eucharist. Even when we go for the Holy Eucharist every day, or every week, and we participate and receive the holy body and blood of Christ, we need to have this desire to be one with the Lord even before receiving the Holy Eucharist. We all prepare our children for the reception of the First Holy Communion. The best way to prepare them for the reception of the First Holy Communion is to teach them to desire for the Lord even before they receive the Lord physically in their body and in their heart. My dear friends, this desire is complemented with the second aspect, embracing the Lord in love. Just as in every human friendships, the benefits of the friendship happen only to the extent of the cordiality between the persons. In our spiritual life also, the spiritual graces are abundantly multiplied in our life when our relationship with the Lord is intact, when our love for Him is shown in our life. We need to remember that Galatians chapter 5, 6 says, we need to receive the Lord with a living faith working through love. It is love that made Jesus to walk to the Calvary and die for each one of us. It is love for me as a person that made Jesus to die for me. That is why we read in Galatians chapter 2, 20 and 21 that He loved me and gave Himself up for me. Therefore, when we receive the Holy Eucharist, we also need to receive Him in love. And we love God not because that we have love, it is because God has loved us first. 1 John chapter 4, 19. Therefore, our love for the Lord can be expressed in some practical ways. First of all, examining and affirming our faith in the real presence of the Lord in the Holy Eucharist celebration, being at home with our neighbor, practice humility in all circumstances, free from mortal sins through act of contrition and confession, and by keeping the Holy Eucharistic fast. My dear friends, one of the expressions of the love of Christ is to guard ourselves from even hurting the Lord or hurting our neighbor, even in minor ways, which is a very difficult task for us. That is why we need a constant examination of our conscience. What will Jesus think about my thoughts? What will Jesus think about my acts? What will Jesus think about my speech? What will Jesus think about my attitudes? I may have to keep this constantly in my mind. Saints used to dread of committing even a venial sin, even going through a moment of imperfection. They used to dread because they knew that minor sin, even an imperfection, that would cause pain in the heart of the Lord. That was the love of saints. During this time, the Lord is inviting us to enter into that kind of spirituality of guarding our life and loving the Lord. Loving the Lord and guarding our life. The third aspect is we receive the Lord in spiritually as if we have actually received Him physically. My dear friends, Holy Eucharistic celebration is in its zenith when we celebrate at the altar, when all of us participate physically. But St. Thomas Aquinas says that we can even avail the effects of the Holy Eucharist in its full measure if we are able to desire for the communion in our heart. The whole effects, the whole spiritual effects can be available to us. Even though we are not physically receiving Him, we can receive all graces, all effects when we desire for Him and lovingly embrace Him as if we have actually received Him. We read in John chapter 13, 20, Jesus says that all those who receive me receives the Father who sent me. So there is a reception that we can do spiritually. When we desire to receive the Lord in the most precious body and blood of the Lord in the Eucharist, we receive Him almost actually. We receive all the graces. In Matthew chapter 8, 5, we have the incident of the centurion who comes and pleads for the healing of his servant to Jesus. And Jesus said that, I will come and heal him. And he says that, no, Master, please, you don't have to come. You just say a word, my servant will be healed. And Jesus upheld his faith and said, go, be it done for you as you have believed. When the centurion went back to his house, he found his servant healed. And when he inquired about the time of his healing, it was the time when Jesus said, go, be it done for you as you have believed. The centurion just desired the healing of his servant. The healing happened in the life of the servant. If at all we desire the Lord to receive him in the most holy Eucharist, the Lord will come. We read in Revelation chapter 3, 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him, and he will with me. This is a situation for everyone who is waiting for the Lord, because he is constantly knocking on the door of our hearts. Whether we are able to receive him physically at the altar or not, he will come to us spiritually if we are able to wait for him, if we are ready to open our hearts. My dear friends, spiritual communion is necessary at this time. And this spiritual practice is applied to the people who are not able to take part in the Holy Eucharist because of sickness, because of the situations like this lockdown or are prevented by some adversities. For such people, spiritual communion is the best option, the wonderful divine plan. It is said about Saint Agatha of the Cross, who received Jesus 200 times a day through spiritual communion. This is a wonderful practice we can begin with. And once we are able to do it with ourselves, and when we are able to communicate the same thing to our children, for them, the actual reception of the Holy Eucharist will be the most sweetest moment in their life. And they will never hurt the Lord. They will never cause pain to the Lord. We are all caring for our beloved ones. We are all caring for our little ones. Let us impart this good spiritual exercise, spiritual practice. And this is the apt time to practice it. May God bless you all. I shall give you for today's retreat some practical steps. First of all, we can have a frequent examination of the conscience. My word, thought, act and attitudes, where they are they in conformity with the Christ? Whether they manifest faith, hope and charity? Do I strive for the fruits of the Holy Spirit in my life? Love, peacefulness, joy, forgiveness, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, patience, self-control, modesty and chastity. Retiring frequently to a few seconds or few minutes of silence, even the busy times, to desire for the body and blood of the Lord in the Holy Eucharist in one's own heart. Reading at least a passage from the Bible, especially I request you to read the chapter 6 of the Gospel of John and chapter 11 of 1 Corinthians. Maybe making the ejaculatory prayers like, "My Lord and Master, my Jesus, I desire it for you every moment of my life." We can use such kind of ejaculatory prayers during this day or the days ahead. Taking a few acts of personal mortification, it is up to each person. May God give you a wonderful Holy Week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.